really flattered to be sharing the stage with Henry Jenkins, an author whose works I've admired for quite a long time, and whose approach to understanding culture, I think, is extremely innovative, and has been very inspiring to me in trying to think about laughter. Right? I was kind of trained as a literary historian, but laughter can't really be confined to literature. It kind of spills over in all kinds of unexpected ways. And early in graduate school, I came across What Made Pistachio Nuts. I'd always been a fan of Monty Python, of the Marx Brothers, but this is a book that I felt really helped me understand how you can write about comedy in an interesting and meaningful way. And I wanted to start by not just advertising the book, also thanking one of my colleagues and friends, Paisa Kuhlmans, currently at Princeton, who introduced me to What Made Pistachio Nuts. He introduced me to the book. And he also let me borrow The Ancient Art of Falling Down for the title of today's event. He had written a conference paper about Jackie Chan and Jackie Chan and how he had used stunts from Buster Keaton and Harold Lloyd and some of the early sound comedians that Henry Jenkins writes about. So I've been very interested in comedy and laughter as a type of culture, and was interested in exploring its literary dimensions and its cinematic dimensions. So in the Age of Irreverence, I kind of trolled to see what was out there in terms of publications, came across a lot of humor magazines, some in Chinese, some in French, some in English, some in multiple languages, so like Shanghai Puck up there on the top left was in English and in Chinese. From this period when China was like transitioning from the Qing Empire into a modern nation state, the Republic of China, at the same time, like, why was this historical moment accompanied by so much laughter, satire, parody, and so on and so forth? So I was interested partly as a phenomenon spurred by a big boom in print media, where you also have things like humor collections. I could call them joke books, but sometimes they have essays, sometimes they have poetry, and the like. You have hundreds of them come out in this period, between the like 1890s and the 1930s, 1940s. So China was undergoing a lot of social turmoil. It is undergoing a regime change, but then it was also accompanied by this proliferation of some what are now ephemera, like kind of pulp and subliterary products. But laughter was something that I think crossed a big socioeconomic spectrum, and you had educated elites working in this field as well as the hacks and the entrepreneurs and so on. So this is kind of a very broad field that I've been interested in. And I look at some of the different manifestations of laughter that I do think congealed into what you could call a comic culture. But it's one that's not so tightly bound. And one thing that I found very early on is that Chinese comic cultures were heavily influenced by international trends. So Henry's written about this extensively, and we decided today to do a bit of a mashup between some of my research and some of his research from long ago and currently. And so we're going to be showing you some still images from the types of materials that we've worked with and analyzed. We're also going to show some film clips, and my daughter is 4. She likes pink. I just bought her a bike horn, and we thought we'd use it for when we need to play a film clip for you. So the first one will be coming up shortly. But first, Henry, do you want to say something about the...
Yeah, so I was going to tell a little bit of my backstory that I had been fascinated. I got fascinated. I was in bed sick with fever some almost 3 decades ago and ended up watching a film called Stand Up and Cheer that is a totally forgotten film. But in the midst of that film, there's a sequence where these senators come in and a very Frank Capra-esque scene to investigate a governmental agency. And the bureaucrats leave the room, and suddenly they burst into backflips and saying things like, "What made pistachio nuts?" And they're rolling in the floor with each other and knocking their heads together and so forth. Very broad physical comedy. And then the bureaucrats come back in the room, and they sit up straight and act very dignified. And I just couldn't figure the scene out. right? And it led me down this path of realizing these two actors were vaudevillians, Mitchell and Durant, who were performing in this film. And the film is itself very strange in many other ways. But that scene of the backflipping senators took me down this path to really think about vaudeville as a tradition in American entertainment. What we see here are just a range of images of classic vaudeville. The guy hanging off the table is the three Keatons. So the small boy next to the table is actually Buster Keaton as a young man who would go on to become famous as a slapstick comedian. But what you see there is the simple insanity, the spectacle, the virtuosity of vaudeville becomes a really driving force in American comedy during the same period that Christopher is talking about in his work. And it's part of a larger change in what comedy means in American culture. So let me set this down for a sec. I'm going to read a couple of quotes from the book as we go through this. So the first quote comes from the late 19th century. And it says, "The great men who dared to laugh at an earlier age than ours laughed in moderation. They held folly up to ridicule, not to amuse the groundlings, but to reveal in a sudden blaze of light the eternal truths of wisdom and justice. They did not at every turn slap their reader on the back and assure him that there is nothing congruous in the visible world. They kept their humor in its proper place. They used it for wise purpose. They did not degrade it for an easy round of applause." Right, the next is from an instructional guide for vaudeville gag writers. "The purpose of the comic sketch is not to leave a single impression of a single story. It points no moral, draws no conclusion, and sometimes it might end quite as effectively anywhere before the place in the action at which it does terminate. It is built for entertainment purposes only, and furthermore, for entertainment purposes that end the moment the sketch ends." So what we're seeing is this friction, a moment of shift in the function of comedy from being a tool of moral instruction to comedy being something for mass amusement. Some moral instruction was tied to particular class perspectives and status. Now it is going to be for everyone. And the success is determined whether people laugh. So in vaudeville, each act is self-contained. It's developing its own material. The theater owner files a card reporting on how well the act went over. And so he's looking for signs from the audience of an emotional response and literally writes down a report on a card and sends it in. So the performer is looking for the wow climax, right, which is a term of the period, the moment that you get the maximum emotional response. So the vaudeville stage is a machine to generate heightened emotion. And it may be weeping, it may be patriotism, it may be gasps and wows, it may be laughter, but you're trying to draw that out. So all the different kinds of acts there in the vaudeville stage in that picture draw out different kinds of emotional responses. This exists alongside other kinds of commercial entertainment. So this is Steeplechase at Coney Island, one of the early amusement parks in America. And note that it's called the funny place, not even the fun place, which we might, or the world for children of all ages, or the happiest place on earth, various slogans we might hear in entertainment. But it's specifically funny, and its icon is that of the smiling and laughing face becomes part of what that style of entertainment is. Now, if you're in the business of developing lots of laughter and getting an emotional response, you become adept at, first of all, putting on and taking off masks. So it's about performer virtuosity. And these performers who come from diverse ethnic backgrounds begin to think of ethnic and racial masks as one of the kinds of identities they can put on and take off. So all of the pictures there are Eddie Cantor from his various film roles. You see up there Eddie Cantor in blackface, Eddie Cantor is a Native American, Eddie Cantor in drag, Eddie Cantor is a Roman, Eddie Cantor is a Spanish matador. So these were different roles or identities Cantor plays at various points in time. Ironically, after about 1930, the one role he can't play is Jewish, right? So he's actually Jewish. His early films reference his Jewishness, and starting about 1930, they strip it away. He's suddenly Russian, not Jewish. This guy who was raised over a delicatessen in the Lower East Side does an ad campaign for Wonder Bread just to escape his Jewish background. And from that point forward, the only reference to Judaism that crops up in Cantor's films is a moment where he's in Egypt, his team has been kidnapped, and he turns to the Egyptian and says, "Let my people go." Right? And that turns immediately into a blackface minstrel number singing it as a serial. And so the Southern Colonel they're with and Cantor blacken up and immediately sing, "Let my people go." And it, so it's shied from being a marker and a winking acknowledgement of Jewishness into something that's going to be recognized as yet another mask that he takes on and puts off. So in this world where you're trying to figure out how to build laughter into a mechanism, literally the stimulus response model of Pavlov becomes a way in which they think of it. So this is Weber and Fields, who are two of the first kind of paired team of Fat and Thin to really dominate in Broadway and vaudeville. They're Dutch comedians in the sense that they're not born Dutch, but they play Dutch characters, which is another of those ethnic types. And they wrote in a piece about their comedy the following scientific statement. An audience will laugh loudest at these episodes. A, when a man sticks one finger into another man's eyes. B, when a man sticks two fingers into another man's eyes. C, when a man chokes another man and shakes his head from side to side. D, when a man kicks another man. E, when a man bumps up suddenly against another man and knocks him off his feet. And F, when a man steps on another man's foot. Human nature, as we've analyzed it with the results that will be told by the cashier at our bank, will laugh louder and oftener at these spectacles in this respective order we have chronicled them than anything else one might name. So there's a kind of, I mean, they're joking, but they're using this language of science and affect to describe this behavior. And so comedians literally among themselves talk about in a language of stimulus response how we evoke laughter from an audience through these small fragmentary bits of stock business that can be added up and put into a context to form a sketch for which there is no moral message, only the pleasure of watching a man poke two fingers into another man's eyes, shake his head about, make him fall down. So I'll turn it back to Chris. Oh, yeah.
One of the things that struck me in trying to compare what was going on in China with what was going on in other places like the US was, you know, late 19th, early 20th century China, cultural confidence was not really high. You know, it was kind of at a low ebb. People were talking about China as a nation, you know, going extinct because of all these pressures from foreign powers. You know, the Japanese were there. There were various concessions to Britain, France, the US, in places like Shanghai. So you had a country that was divided in a lot of ways. And I called my book The Age of Irreverence partly because I felt like a lot of the old authorities had really lost their prestige and their authority. And so the kind of laughter was, you could say, a symptom, but also a mechanism for kind of further eroding their authority and expressing skepticism towards all of this kind of received wisdom. But at the same time, when I started reading, you know, watching comic films, reading comedic literature and criticism, I felt like you hear a lot of the same voices working against it, right? Some are very moralizing voices that will seem patronizing, kind of archaic to us now, but the quote that one of the quotes that Henry read, you know, people were worried that laughter would just kind of further erode the Chinese nation state and push it into an abyss. But at the same time, I feel like the ethos of irreverence was one that was quite liberating to some people, and they felt like they would actually gain confidence to try more experimentation. So for example, Mutt and Jeff was a very influential turn of the 20th century or early 20th century comic strip in the US, widely serialized, read by millions, including people overseas in China. And so, you know, trolling through some old magazines, I would find the same iconography. And I haven't tracked down to see if this is an actual Mutt and Jeff strip that was just transplanted, or if they used the same iconography to create a new series. But you had a lot of kind of short-term experimentation. Eventually in the 20s and 30s, you got Chinese cartoonists creating their own serial characters, like Wang Xiansheng, Mr. Wang, a creation of Yechen Yu, who became kind of the first really successful, almost franchised Chinese comic figure. They made movies out of them, based on this character, and so on and so forth. At the same time, you also had kind of direct importation and translation of cartoons from The Humorist, from The New Yorker, from foreign media outlets that became kind of part of Chinese humor culture. So it's not like it was bounded off and there was a Chinese sense of humor over here and an American sense of humor over there. It was very eclectic. There was quite a lot of mixing going on.
So yeah, having seen that previous image in his PowerPoint, I dug these images out. So if we go to the next one there, which come from the American slapstick tradition. The bottom is Rube Goldberg, whose name is still synonymous to kind of these improbable mechanical devices where enormous amount of energy is expended to accomplish very little. Above, we see Chaplin in the modern times, where he has an efficiency device that's being made fun of, where the worker doesn't have to quit his job in order to be fed. There's no release from constant assembly line work. And the other one there is lesser known, is a guy named Charlie Bauer, whose work is just beginning to be discovered by scholars of slapstick. It was forgotten for the better part of the 20th century. It's now been recovered from archives. You can now do a DVD, but it's all about devices, mechanical objects, how you create things, how you use the modern era of technology to do improbable and unlikely things. So this is just a glimpse of the background to that previous line.
Yeah, and you know, there's a question of like, how do you trace cultural flows between different places? And one could be through like memes. I think cinema scholars have been particularly strong in kind of leading the way in trying to identify like the vocabulary of film and the grammar of film, and like what stock scenarios do you have and what motifs do you have over and over. So we see some of these in cartoons, right? There's an explosion in cartooning in China in the 20s. It was partly in 1928 because there was a new government established in Nanjing and there was a bit more stable. The warlord era had kind of come to a close then. So there was more institution building going on then, right? This is a few decades after what was going on in the US, but part of that is attributable to China being a poorer place and having a lot of internal turmoil. But we also see experimentation in cinema. So just like in vaudeville and early American cinema, a lot of the actors in China who you see on screen were dramatists first, right? They were playwrights, they were stage actors, and then they would like buy a secondhand camera and start a film company with their buddies from the theater world. And they were also film goers. And they were seeing films that had been imported to China from around the world. This is Laborer's Love, which there's a still image of here. We'll watch a clip of in a minute. The clips I'm showing are slightly longer because I'm assuming people haven't seen these films too much. And so to give you a sense of the texture and a little bit of the narrative flow. But you can see just from the still image, right, people falling down appealed in China. And this is the first film made by a new film company that was really a grassroots shoestring organization. The directors were both from the theater world, and they're both considered to be pioneers of the stage and the screen in China, very important in Chinese cinema history, and they acted them themselves. So we'll see Zheng Zhengqiu appearing in one role in Laborer's Love. This is a brief synopsis, but it's a love story, and it's a story of love possibly being thwarted by a father figure, Dr. Zhu, right? So the two young people. One interesting character whose background is only partially covered in this script is Carpenter Zheng. So he was formerly a carpenter. He's now come up north, presumably to Shanghai, but he's changed to trades and he's now working as a fruit seller. And so early in the film, there's a device. He sends a token of his affection to the doctor's daughter by sending some fruit over. And it's on a wire with a little basket, and it goes from one stall to another over to her, and then she sends like her handkerchief back to him and so on and so forth. So this is one of the way that they court each other. but she still needs her father's permission in order to marry this guy. So there's a traditional morality at work here, but that gets a comic treatment. And so we'll play the first clip now, and this is how the carpenter goes about bringing business to his prospective father-in-law. This is a silent film, so we're just going to watch the last 7 or so minutes of it. So it's a short film. It's only about 20 minutes long, but I feel like there's a lot going on in there, right? You know, some of you may have seen Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times, where the man gets caught in the assembly line, and here they actually created an assembly line by working together and, you know, processing humans, and you know, all the movements are really jerky like a machine. So it seems like a common or shared comic interest in how, you know, modernity is changing human life, and, you know, how machines are affecting people. And part of that special effect is, of course, enabled by a machine, right? It's enabled by this kind of the film camera itself, which allows the fast forward and the like. And this is one of three films. Unfortunately, the other two don't exist, right? This is the earliest Chinese film that we can see, but it was at least envisioned as part of a comic trilogy. More films were made later on, but, you know, at this time in cinematic history in China, comedy really sold, and there was a lot of interest in experimenting with the camera. So, for example, with The King of Comedy Visits Shanghai, we do have one still. This was a film that had a multinational cast. So the guy who played Charlie Chaplin's little tramp was not Charlie Chaplin. It was a British resident of Shanghai, you know, who adopted the cane and the hat and the tight-fitting clothes and mustache and so on and so forth to make a, you know, a fan version for the local market. So I hope that the archive will reveal more of these films hidden away somewhere. But this was also a film that's interesting because it was not just made for a Chinese market. It was also made with a potential foreign market in mind, right? Why else do we have these intertitles in Chinese and in English? And sometimes the English translation is really, you know, going for laughs more than the Chinese, right? I feel so good I could fly. That's not in the original Chinese there. You know, one of the centerpieces of this film is this trick staircase, right, that turns into a slide. And this is an ingenious and very creative device, but it's not an original one. So we see from just 1 year earlier, Buster Keaton had The Haunted House. And I'm going to turn it over to Henry to show that this is actually a motif that was very popular and used very widely.
Yeah, so if we think about what I said so far about vaudeville comedy depending on gags as units that might be combined in a variety of ways, in the ways that Weber and Fields talked about it, we should not be surprised that they're repeated motifs, gags that occur again and again. And indeed, one of my grad students some years back, Andreas Lombada, traced many of these tropes back to Commedia dell'arte in Italy, which had carefully cataloged a variety of gag settings. So I'm going to show a montage in a second from a number of films. Begins with a series of versions of the staircase gag. Then we will get a bit of Coney Island in that same time period. So you can see how those kinds of gag situations are built into attractions, rides, things that are designed to take tourists and throw them off their feet, quite literally. And then we'll see some doctor gags, which is the second kind of gag theme that we could trace back to Commedia dell'arte that we saw in the segment we just saw. So all of those contortion jokes involving doctors. So we'll see some of these are from silent films, some sound films. Everything I've got is American films that are coming out of the slapstick vaudeville style tradition. So I guess we will
do the honors. Yeah.
I will do the honors. So this is Buster Keaton. And he plays an electrician in this, not a carpenter, but he's designed a house which everything is has electric power that allows you to do extraordinary things. So here it's an escalator, not a stairs. What we're seeing is another electrician, he's gotten fired from his job, is getting revenge by manipulating the escalator, much to his confusion. So we skip a little bit and this is the same sequence continuing. And so this is Chaplin's 1 a.m. He's coming back drunk at night and faces a different kind of problem with stairs. So this film, 1 a.m., is more or less a one-man comedy from beginning to end, and much of it in the same shot, so we know it's shot more or less in real time. And so slapstick, American slapstick comedy wants to have that sense of, you see, preserve the time and space, so we recognize the virtuosity of the performer's body and what they can do. So it really is just him just interacting with a series of props, and it's closest to what he was famous for doing in the British Music Hall, of anything that we have preserved of Chaplin's work. This is Olson and Johnson, 1941. I So again, the same stairway gag, now they're thrown straight into hell. So it's a comedy set mostly in hell. So this is the footage. The crowd gives us this footage of Coney Island during that period. So these are things you would actually experience if you went to Coney Island. That it's both fun to be the objects here and the people riding the rides, but also they design spaces where you could watch other people riding and being humiliated by being thrown about and forced to fall. Now here's W.C. Fields as a dentist. Pretty amazing.
Have you ever had this tooth pulled before?
No.
This won't hurt you much.
Get your foot out. Ow.
And now this is Eddie Cantor and Charlotte Greenwood, who I'll talk about Charlotte a little later.
A good massage is what you need. That's
well, what are you
going to
do now?
I'm going to give you a good massage.
Well, I don't want to.
You don't realize how happy I am to be able
yeah,
to do something for you that's going to do you so much good.
Well, how about me? Why didn't you ask me,
dear boy? Why, darling, you've got two left legs.
I was all together before I got on that horse.
Well, don't worry. I'll make it right.
Oh, what are you doing? You're crippled. What are you doing that for?
Do you think, sweetheart, that you could ever learn to love me?
I'm dying and she asks me riddles.
Now, this may seem unnecessary, dear, but it's very, very necessary.
Necessary for whom?
For you, dear. This will make you robust.
Did you say robust or robo?
This is good for your diaphragm.
Nothing wrong with my frying pan.
Now I've got to unravel you.
Oh,
at last I meet the man of my dreams face to face. Oh, how often... Do you feel better, darling?
Yeah, pretty soon I won't feel anything at all.
Oh, do you think you could marry me now?
Yeah, just keep on hitting me till I'm in the mood.
Oh, if you only knew what I feel for you.
What do you mean?
There isn't any sacrifice I wouldn't make for you. I wouldn't... I'd give you everything. Come back here. I haven't finished with you yet. Oh, I love you so.
Come on.
Okay, so I think you can see that the doctor-dentist gags really become an excuse for contortionism of one sort or another and very broad physical comedy. That shaking someone's head back and forth that Weber and Fields talked about. Whereas the staircase becomes about physical dexterity and about engineering feats, both of which work together, I think, in silent film comedy in the US to sort of create the worldview that Chaplin, Keaton, Langdon, and Lloyd are most famous for.
Yeah, I haven't watched as much Cantor as you have, but I get the sense he really earned his money, the contortionism. But like, yeah, I feel like a lot of the comedy here, it's like a comedy of expediency or something. So like when your escalator's not working, you just slide down the banister. Or in Labor is Love, the opening titles in English say that this is a carpenter who uses the tools of his trade to get what he wants. So whatever your trade is, it seems like there's kind of a professional craftsman aesthetic at work here. And we see the staircases. We also see staircases repeated later, also in the 1940s. One of the last films made before the communist takeover in 1949 was a film that is both in kind of a tragic comic vein, right? It deals with the pathos of an orphan in the streets of Shanghai. The war from 1937 to 1945 against Japan had created a lot of orphans. And so they were a really conspicuous presence. And San Mao has three hairs on his head and is out there, but he's adopted by a family. He gets involved with street ruffians, and there's some camaraderie between all these starving orphans in the street. But he gets adopted by a high society family, which has a party, and San Mao has been all dressed up in a tuxedo or a nice little suit, but he eventually sheds it, and he helps his friend sneak in the back door. So when his adopted mother goes to find out what's going on, she climbs up the staircase, and eventually the house is overrun with these orphans. So we have a lot of upperly mobile and downwardly mobile orphans sliding down the banister as dad's going upstairs. And this kind of bedlam aesthetic breaks out. So it's a very interesting film that I only realized when we were kind of having an exchange in advance of today's talk, that this was something that comes back again and again, even in Chinese film, where we don't have as big of an archive. Unfortunately, a lot of these early films, the Japanese bombed Shanghai in 1932, and so some of the films were destroyed. But we have destructive bedlam for our amusement in these films.
So I, responding to those images, I sort of wanted to point out that this class conflict is a central building block of American silent film comedy during that same period, ultimately resulting in destructive bedlam. So the battle of the century is Hal Roach's film with Laurel and Hardy, which results in a 100-person pie fight, that the entire streets are overflowing with people smashing each other in the face with pies, and it grows out of occupational and class conflicts. So upper class people and lower class people getting their frustrations out by slamming pies into each other's face. If we get a chap. And that same class conflict is there by the time we get to the Marx Brothers, often played out with Margaret Dumont as the dowager, the wealthy person, the Marx Brothers in various ways being interlopers, disruptors, who often come from street backgrounds. Groucho's a kind of shyster, Chico's an Italian stereotype, Harpo does silent bodily comedy, but they're all often disrupting universities, elite parties, ocean liners, which are for the elite. Each time, they're going into a space that's associated with powerful, wealthy people, and they represent the voice of the street who dismantles that. And then probably the most potent of those is the Three Stooges, right? Because there's nothing classy at all about the Three Stooges. They do come from this incredibly lumpen proletariat background, broad physical comedy, and they're often situated in the settings where they're either passing themselves off as professionals who are dismantled every job that they work on, or they're situated, they're moving into a social, elite social space and systematically dismantle creative destruction, the environments that they find themselves inserted into. So class politics shapes this kind of comedy every bit as much in the US as it does in China during that period.
Another thing I wanted to point out, again, kind of in our reading of Labor is Love, is you see the glasses, right? This was a film that was responding to the popularity of Harold Lloyd. He was more popular than Chaplin in China for many years. He was known for his Lonesome Luke character and for a character just known as the glasses. Had this kind of iconic look, boyish, optimistic, and also with these, you know, something that draws attention to the expressiveness of his eyes, right, the actual spectacles. So we see those being used in Labor is Love, I'll show it in a minute, as well as in this film, Never Weaken, which was another film made just a year before Labor is Love, also has this plot element of a doctor and a young lady working for him, and then a young striver who wants to marry her or wants to partner with her, but business is bad, so the guy has to help think of something. But as the glasses, and this would appear in Shanghai film fanzines, right? The very first issue of the Motion Picture Review in Shanghai had Harold Lloyd on the cover. And so we see this type of iconography with Carpenter Jung, as well as with the doctor, right, Dr. Zhu. So both of them are kind of acting as well as even the filmmaker himself. You know, I was looking at a photo of Zheng Zhengqiu, and he has the same glasses. So this is very popular. And if you look at Chinese, just regular literary magazines or, you know, fashion magazines, spectacle stores, glasses stores would sell this and market it as luo ke, as the Lloyd-style glasses. Oops.
So the same pattern of imitating Harold Lloyd carried over to Japan, and John Dower, who's an historian of Japanese culture between the wars, points out that by World War II, those glasses become emblematic of the propagandistic images of the Japs. So when you see the Japanese image in World War II movies with the thick glasses, it's actually Japanese attempts to mimic Harold Lloyd to seem modern and Western, that is now turned into a frightening propaganda image that sort of makes the Japanese seem alien to American culture. So it's a weird kind of cycle with the glasses undergoes.
And actually in the 1950s, a lot of the anti-Japanese films after World War II use exactly that iconography of the, you know, Coke bottle glasses Japanese.
So the other reason I threw this one up is to sort of say that Lloyd and the history of American slapstick comedy represents this movement from gags that could be performed on stage to gags that could only have been performed in cinema, that require kind of elaborate, even more elaborate physical spaces. So in Safety Last, his best film, he literally climbs three different skyscrapers in order to get the footage for that movie. But interestingly, having moved to LA, I learned, and I live in Broadway and 9th at the Eastern Columbia Building, It turns out it's only two buildings down is one of the skyscrapers that Sarah Lloyd climbs to the top of in Safety Last. So we live surrounded by the settings that these performers used. By the time Harold Lloyd films this particular famous sequence, he's already blown three fingers off of one of his hands doing another gag. And so he wears a rubber glove on that hand. So it's not enough that he's climbing the side of an actual skyscraper and hanging on by one hand at various points, but he's actually holding on by two fingers on one hand in some of these sequences when we watch it. So that sense of just doing the extraordinary in real spaces as a kind of slapstick comedy that is bigger than can ever have been done in the theatrical setting is an important part of the appeal of Harold Lloyd around the world.
Yeah, and Jackie Chan, again, has been really to credit for re-establishing that connection even in modern kung fu comedy and replicating this stunt exactly, but with more fingers. So you see trick cinematography. We looked at the fast forward, but we have this image I think is interesting. It appears briefly he's thinking of his lady love and, you know, their future together, presumably. But this responds to, and is in some ways an extension of trick photography. You could go to a photo studio in Shanghai or in even second tier cities and buy what was called a two me's photo or a split cell photograph. So you see in the top left there, that is the same woman. And it's kind of double exposure. So she's dressed as a country bumpkin and as a fine lady, you know, asking for money for herself, a self-beseeching photo. But you also had this in magazines where the editors of the magazine would go to a studio and they would all get shots taken of themselves as a strong man holding themselves up. So it's a similar like play with gadgetry. The one on the bottom is a man playing chess with himself. And this is something that you find in Europe. So in the late 19th century, artists and just regular consumers would also buy this type of novelty image. And you even get them being sent around the world as postcards, right? So people would like get this, or the people would frame them on their walls. So some people have written about China's encounter with modern technology as being like, oh, there's a ghost in the machine. This is violating a lot of old taboos. And so you shouldn't mess with you shouldn't have your photograph taken. It'll steal your soul. There's one school of thought that I think is somewhat confounded when you see images like this that clearly show people having fun with the technology. And, you know, it is a type of common amusement, at least among a certain social class. And it's working its way into cinema as well, right? Even the deposed last emperor of China, right, Puyi, had a photo session taken where he appeared in double. He doesn't look like he's very having a lot of fun here, but presumably this was done for fun and for amusement. So it went, you know, all the way up and down the hierarchy. This is a postcard that I found really striking for a number of reasons. Partly I can, you know, recognize it as a type of studio portraiture that was very common in the late 19th and early 20th century. However, this guy has this really excited expression on his face that is like the expressive, emoting, you know, over-the-top thing that you get in films like Labor's Love, where there's a lot of showy like head waggling and broad smiles and open mouth, so on and so forth. So even though the Chinaman eating rice, then nowadays may seem a little weird, but this seems like this guy is in on the joke, or he's having fun with it. And this photo was used for a salad dressing advertisement. That's the product you see up on the top. But the captions are, you know, in three languages, right? Two Western languages on the bottom and then Chinese on the side. And then the script at the bottom, you know, the handwriting is in French. So presumably this was sent overseas. So, and just like that film was made for an international market, you have a type of circulation going on in print as well that I think is quite interesting. Wanted to show a couple more Chinese clips. The next one is actually from a 1930s film. And two of the people that we'll see in it were known as kind of China's Laurel and Hardy, right? The skinny man, fat man duo. We'll see a couple of clips from a couple of films in which they appear. But one from 1934, when the Chinese cinema industry was getting rolling. And some of the comic performance and behaviors will seem quite familiar. But there's another comedian an actress or actor who is appearing in this film. And this is Lili Li. She was known as like the sweet big sister. She had like a very, you know, robust physique. She was always smiling, you know, very approachable on-screen persona. She's introduced in this film sports queen as being a very athletic type. She's a girl from the countryside, and she arrives in Shanghai by boat. And when her family members get off the boat, they can't find her. Why? Because she's climbed up the smokestack of the ship, right? Because it's just like the trees she used to climb back home, right? So from the, her character introduction is quite striking in this film as someone who's got really a robust, overt physicality. When she's in Shanghai, she's introduced around. She gets, you know, it's a typical like naive girl coming to the big city. Is it going to corrupt her or is it not? But there's a potential love match made. And I'm sorry, it's a slightly small images here. But there's a sequence, again, involving a staircase where there's this young Master Gao, who's a very stiff, kind of mechanical, dandyish figure. And when she's being set up with him, she runs down, chasing her dog down the staircase, knocks her aunt over. You know, the dog jumps on this character. She jumps into her, presumably, beau's arm and completely overwhelms him. So we'll see not too much of her comic performance in this next clip, but I just want to mention that you know, her expressiveness and her bodily comedy is one of the attractions and appeals, in this film. So, sports queen. So Sports Queen is a really good film if you like to look at women's legs. But I love that dissolve where we move from the women's butts to the guy, to the guys' butts, and right, the kind of different type of pleasure, right? Visual pleasure and watching these guys perform. And there's really interesting things going on in this film in terms of gender representations and so on. And we haven't looked at the clips that really showcase Li Li Li's athleticism. But in that part where there's a dialogue between the Laurel and Hardy characters, and one of them's like, "You got to imitate me, and like be really fast in doing your work." I feel like he's saying you have to be just as athletic as me, right? And you know, waking up, taking a dump, brushing your teeth, so on and so forth. I did find a version of this film on YouTube with subtitles, but they cut out the taking the dump. So somebody censored out the scatology in that little comic sequence there. But he has this little suspenders move, which to me is quite athletic, and is a type of a visual gag. And then of course they get caught in the doorway when they're trying to get out. But this is a very typical type of performance that would be recognizable to Chinese filmgoers who had seen Laurel and Hardy.
All right, so I thought, so in responding to that clip, I pulled two things. The first is a segment from a Laurel and Hardy film, a film that features Laurel and Hardy called Hollywood Party, which is not one of their solo films. It's part of an ensemble. And they're cast there against a woman named Lupi Velez, who was a Latina, Mexican-born comedian, and so I thought it was particularly interesting to look at. One of the things about Laurel and Hardy is that while silent slapstick was off in America is often sped up for that comic efficiency, he's talking about Laurel and Hardy slows things down. So there's a kind of slow, ritualized display of violence and aggression here, where each person carefully takes turns and then reacts to each other, that I think is a really important part of understanding how Laurel and Hardy's comedy work. And you'll see it as a three-way with Lupi Velez in this sequence. The other thing is, Hardy is definitely the most powerful figure of Laurel and Hardy. And it looks like that role is reversed in the segment you just showed us. So it's interesting to see a different the pairing with a different power dynamic. So with that in mind, let's look at Hollywood Party.
Oh, yes, many times.
I want some service.
Mr. Durante says, Miss Velez, that if you came to this party, you weren't to have anything to drink.
I don't care whatever you say. I want service.
I know, but he said no more tonight.
I don't care. I want some service. I'm going to wreck this place.
Thank you. Sit down. I want to talk to you.
All right, but make it snappy.
So there's no taking dumps in this, but there's the face look on Oliver Hardy's face as the egg slides down his body is every bit as scatological, I'd argue. And this, the sort of gender wars that are represented there. So the second clip I'm going to show is also from Palmy Days, the Eddie Cantor film we saw before. But this features Charlotte Greenwood, who was one of the top female comedians of the period. And one of the things I was happy about with my book was I really dug up a number of these female clowns of the early sound period who really had been written out of the history of comedy. And at down to the present day, if Tina Fey or Amy Schumer or, you know, Sarah Silverman are constantly bombarded with questions about whether women can be funny, whether they're breaking new boundaries by being female comedians. And in fact, women run through the history of comedy. They just get written out by subsequent generations. They're left out of these histories of comedy. So this scene with Charlotte Greenwood, she's cast as the female clown, and she's surrounded by athletic women again. And this, so this is sort of looks, borrows a lot from the kind of voyeuristic stuff that we saw in Sports Queen.
That's fine, Jane. You're getting to look more like me every day, heaven help you. Oh, Nadine, watch yourself. Dangerous curves ahead. Reach for a pickle instead of a pie. Mary, you've gained 2 pounds since last week. Didn't I tell you to cut out the French pastry?
Honestly, Miss Martin, I haven't touched any sweet.
I guess I know French pastry when I see it. Now, you all better listen to me. Nowadays, the average maiden is extremely overladen with what's known as adipose tissue. To retain that normal svelte line in the region of your belt line has grown a national issue. Dietitians and physicians favor this and that, but there's only one sure way of reducing that fat. You've got to thin down, sister. Thin down, sister, if you want to keep it. No more messing with French dressing. Thin down, sister, and breathe. You may flirt with noodle soup. Sniff, but don't give in. You've got to thin down, sister. Thin down, sister, if you want to keep it. forget your sun bath on the roof this afternoon.
Oh, Miss Martin, the last few days, aviators have been flying over our roof.
They have?
Yes.
Why, the idea. I'll be up there this afternoon myself. Well, what do you think of that?
And an egg should always be outside the cage.
So that sequence was one of the first that Busby Berkeley did for Hollywood. Berkeley had been the assistant of a guy named Charles Urban, who staged similar kinds of numbers for the Ziegfeld Follies, and which had a tradition of glorifying the American girl. So what we see there is that kind of showing off, getting women as undressed as we possibly can. The bend down sister bit obviously has obvious motivations. This is an early pre-production code crackdown film, so it has just that little bit of cheesecake spice built into it. What was interesting to me about Sports Queen is it looks like the sexy, cute girl and the comic girl can be combined in that film. Whereas here we see the female comedians of the 30s tend to be sort of failed examples of femininity. They are in one way too tall, too fat, too ugly in one way or another, so that their comedy comes out of trying to be attractive, thinking of themselves as attractive, doing very physical things, but not being the glorified girl. So this is some stills of Charlotte Greenwood. She's famous for her high kicks, and she can do the same amount of physical dexterity and stunts as any of the male comedians of the period, but it's often presented in her case as, on the one hand, a woman seeking desire and pleasure on her own terms, which is what makes them still feel liberated in some ways, and she would go into towns ahead of the films and challenge men to foot races and usually beat them. So that she was trying to prove her physicality, but her tall lankiness is usually read as kind of ugly, not particularly feminine, and so forth. This is Winnie Leitner, another one of the women I wrote about in What Made Pistachio Nuts, and she did a lot of stuff around burlesque, and she has a song about look me over here, look me over there. The joke of which is she's calling attention to her body, but at the same time, in Hollywood standards, she's not supposed to be particularly attractive. And in this, but Lupe Velez does get to be sexually attractive, glamorous even. But in another way, she's crossing a line because she's Mexican, and she's cast as the Mexican Spitfire in most of the films that she performs. And so her hot temper makes her dangerous. And you hear the here, a lot of the language describing her as a persona is like hot tamale, paprika. It's so spicy, it tastes real good, but it burns your tongue. You've got to watch out. It's sort of the play on her ethnicity becomes really central to her character. And I've written a standalone piece about Lupe Velez and the ways in which her Mexicanness is set against, say, Dolores del Rio, who was a more light-skinned Mexican woman of the same vintage, who Hollywood kid cast as a romantic lead, whereas Lupe is more working class, more darker skin, and the result is that she usually gets cast as a comic lead, even though she clearly has a lot of sexual attractiveness by the standards of the time. All right, turn it back over to you.
Sure. I think Lili Lee, it was one of those actresses who could be both comedic and sexy at the same time. And the sequences within Sports Queen do kind of set her off from the other two clowns, the Laurel and Hardy clowns. They have like separate sequences that don't integrate too much. And in Sports Queens, a lot of the narrative does end up with, you need like some male paternalistic figure to come in and tame this unrestrained woman and not have her get too full of herself. So there is that rather conservative element there. But you have other productions by Chinese studios at the time, such as Lianhua is one of the big studios, and they would make like a sampler film. They called it Lianhua Symphony, where you would have a bunch of different genre films, maybe four different genres, you know, all shorts that were put together. So to kind of provide this the type of variety and to showcase certain performers. So in one section, it's not enough to have just one Hardy, you have two Hardys, you have one Laurel and two Hardys interacting with each other in the comedic film that appeared within that. And I wanted to show a couple of clips from one last film to raise the question of like, how did this change? How did this vaudeville kind of variety, virtuoso comic performance aesthetic change in like the People's Republic of China? Very different regime, hostile to a lot of frivolity and urbanity, right? The communists had gotten their support from the countryside mostly, and were very suspicious of a lot of these institutions like amusement halls and the like. So we have this same comic duo returning in a film called Unfinished Comedies. And Unfinished Comedies is a fascinating film. It was banned pretty much immediately upon its release in 1957. So actually, I don't think it was really screened until the 1980s when the print was rediscovered. But it has three films within a film. And it's very autobiographical in some ways. So the filmmaker Liu Ban had been unhappy with the state of comedy in the first years of the People's Republic. He felt like there were a lot of restrictions on directors. And so he made a film in which there is a director, a film director at the Changchun Film Studio, where Liu Ban himself actually worked, who's made several films, including one bringing this duo back together, where they've been apart for 10 years or so. But his nemesis is a director, the Comrade Bludgeon. Comrade Bludgeon is a censor, the in-house censor who comes around. And so they have a screening of three films that director Lee has made. And then we get Comrade Bludgeon's negative reaction to all three of them. So I just wanted to start by showing a clip of from the first of the three films that are films within a film. And within this we have a manager, well, part of it is narrated in advance. But we have a manager who comes and has an interaction with his subordinate. So let's roll and see what happens.
开始吧。我们今天演三个小戏，第一个节目是从苏联讽刺小品《别托夫传》中的一小段发展出来的。据说有一位朱经理，他活着的时候 爱铺张，死了以后呢，还要摆阔气。请大家注意，我们这不是正式演出，只是做一次练习。
演戏懂吗？图样上没有舞台的，那么演戏懂吗？图样上没有，你就不许动动脑筋，独立思考了。告诉他们，明天补修一个，要大一点的，要能演京戏、话剧、歌舞什么的，否则就。
So manager Hogg is off to the fat farm. But you know, we have the story that begins, and then all of a sudden we like stop and we have the interlude where we're just like looking in the haha mirror and like showing off our bodies. And it's like you can forget yourself looking in one of these mirrors, right? You forget that you're a stern manager, like telling your, you know, shouting at your subordinates. And it's also, I think, an image that would take viewers back if they had been able to see it, right? So they enjoy this laugh together, and it's all good fun. But like, if you recognize these characters, you would recognize not just this type of fun bodily performances, you know, Han Lan Gang's grimaces, Yin Xiu Chen's you know, rotund body doing interesting movements. You would also recognize the object itself, right? The haha mirror, the funhouse mirror, was really closely associated with a type of urban institution that you found in Shanghai, you found in Singapore, you found in other cities, Hong Kong. So they had these amusement halls that offered a new type of approach to entertainment that was very, very much about variety and choose your own adventure. So you could go into the great world or the new world, and at the entrance, you would see multiple haha mirrors. Some of them were, many of them were imported from Holland, I discovered, or imported from Japan. So in the clip we just saw, Han Lan Gang's character says, it's really hard to get these things, right? I had to send someone down to Shanghai. He's like, go get some more. You know, go, if they don't have any in Shanghai, go down to Guangzhou, go further afield. But so now it's like a paucity of this type of comic delight because we're not producing them anymore and they're hard to get. So this is a film that is in some ways about the continuity or rupture in this comic tradition symbolized by the performers and by this object themselves. So you see these the mirrors in China, and also,
yeah. So I, responding to this clip, I thought about how what roles mirrors play in American slapstick comedy, and thought about a sequence involving the Marx Brothers that appears in Duck Soup, part of which depends on the fact that they actually are brothers. So there is a family resemblance between these these performers that they are going to exploit in the sequence you're about to see. I guess the other thing is we see Boss Hogg in that as a powerful person. Groucho in this is president of Fredonia, president of a country. So whereas the other two brothers in the sequence are street spies hired off the streets to infiltrate the positions of power. So with that, let's...
Get me headquarters. Not hindquarters, headquarters. Hello? Rush the guards right over to Mrs. Teasdale's and have them surround the house.
Later in the film Unfinished Comedies, in the first of the three comedies within the comedy that we see, the ha-ha mirror reappears. But Manager Hogg has gone off to the fat farm. He had his pocket picked on the train by a thief, and then the thief fell out of the train and died, and his head was smashed. So, but they recovered the body, and they recovered Manager Hogg's wallet. So the tone is quite different when he returns.
Thank you. 我见鬼，你不是人，是鬼啊！胡说，这是我见鬼，这活见鬼。朱经理，我知道你是在冤枉、灵魂不安、想家、想我们。胡说！你还胡说些什么？你再胡说，把他赶出去！ 不要发脾气，为你的伤势，我已经三天三夜没睡觉了。我告诉你，我不是鬼，我是活人，我是人。什么？你没死？我只是死了，我不到疗养所去疗养了吗？这么说，你不是死人？嗯，不对，不对。 你是死人，你的职工证和钱包都在死人身上掏出来的。嗯，啊，我的职工证跟钱包都丢了呀。嗯，没事。你要是没有死，我叫你三声，你能不能答应我？ 要没有死，把手放上去烤一烤。你能不能让我摸一摸？
追悼词，给谁写的？给您，给我写追悼词，拿来给我看。好。嗯，嗯，这个看来基本上还不错，就是中间这一句。 太简单了，太空洞，应该这样改。安息吧，朱经理，你将永远活在我们的心里，你的名字将永垂不朽，万古流芳。哎，这样改。 才有感情，才有艺术性。嗯嗯嗯，好，好，好，这改的太好了，你真是天才。这是怎么搞的？
这张相，请画店用碳金画的。
你太小气了，为什么不放那么大张照片呢？ 一人这一生当中，只能死这点遍也行。
这是谁送的？
是王科长送的。
哎呀呀呀！老王也太小气了，那么点钱都舍不得花，这么大点的花圈也拿出手。这谁送的？
是牛科长送的。
嗯，老牛还不错，这个花圈多少还像样子。嗯，这碗袋太不合规则了，怎么能够随随便便的用纸写呢？应该用缎子，最起码也得用布写呀。
So to me, that's like a really stark framing. I wanted to close with that, partly because it seems to me like a comic filmmaker's response to those who would like prematurely try to bury comedy, right? So we have, you know, the return of the haha mirror, which really does create a ghost, and the rhetoric of ghosts was also had particular resonance in China at this moment because of a film, previously a stage play called The White-Haired Girl, where, you know, back in the bad old days where there had been landlords, the landlord had oppressed the woman, raped her, she had to hide in the mountains, she suffered from vitamin deficiency, her hair turned white, she would run down to the temple at night and steal food, and so people all thought that she was a ghost. But when the communist army arrived, they helped her, you know, become human again. So the slogan was, the old society turns humans into ghosts, and the new society is going to turn ghosts back into humans. But here we have these comedians being turned into ghosts, you know, putatively. And so all of that, like, I'm not dead, you know, I'm alive, I'm a real person. Seems like a cri de coeur, right? It seems like this comic filmmaker arguing for comedy and, you know, really making it stark in the presentation of these two icons of the old society's comic culture, right, being killed off. And so trying to fight back. But again, this film was banned. And again, there's a lot of interesting stuff going on with this, like trial by fire, right? A lot of intellectuals are undergoing their own trial by fire in this period. But
So I thought I would close by just observing what happens to the strand of American film comedy, both in terms of thematic, that is, how does it pull into the orbit of propaganda, which is going to happen as the 30s gives way to the 1940s. And formally, the pleasure of performance we see in something like the mirror sequence in the Marx Brothers film that stops the story dead gives way to more and more to forced narrative, linear narratives in which the comedians get expelled from the center of their own movies. And they, in that sense, become ghosts also. So here we see three films in the 1930s, Wheeler and Woolsey's Diplomaniacs, W.C. Fields' Million Dollar Legs, and the Marx Brothers' Duck Soup, all of which feature the comedians in political roles as head of nation states, so forth, but not specific nations, right? The comedy is to displace it into some imaginary European kingdom that they are left as leader of. They are treated as buffoons, fools, knuckleheads, in short, total trumps. The sense of these trumps shifts by the 1940s, where, if we go to this last slide here, they are then specifically cast in relation to the Nazis, the fascists in Italy. So here we see Chaplin's Great Dictator. We see the Three Stooges did a series of films where they play the leaders of Germany and Italy. And we see the Disney film Der Führer's Face, all of which are slapstick comedies where they are specifically harnessed this kind of broad physical comedy toward the purposes of taking down dictators in Europe and rallying support for the troops in the United States. But each in their own way is now marginal, right? The Three Stooges are shorts for Columbia, the smallest and weakest of the studios in the Hollywood system. Chaplin has now been forced to move from silent comedy to sound as his power has diminished, and Disney is doing this as an animated short in front of the film. There are almost none of what I would call the anarchistic comedies coming out by the 1940s. That style of comedy had just been pushed out of the Hollywood system, beholding to both the goals of propaganda and narrative, which constrained the free play of laughter that's part of the 1930s, 1920s era slapstick.
Yeah, and I would say in closing that and the ancient art of falling down is still alive in China. I don't know if I could say it's alive and well, but you do because there is indeed very heavy censorship and a lot of things are taboo, are really off limits, and it's not negotiable. But online, you do get a lot of bricolage videos, you do get things that are put up there and maybe taken down later, but they do exist. And you do have some mainstream filmmakers like Jiang Wen doing very edgy stuff in films like Devils on the Doorstep, which turns Japanese war criminals into buffoons and comic figures in a way that's extremely subversive and works against the mainstream discourses. So it is still possible, the talent is still there, and but it remains to be seen how things will develop in the future.
Okay.
Thanks very much.